Yes, good morning, students. Today we have got the poem A Legend of the Northland with us. So before we discuss anything about the poem, so first let's have a reading of this poem. Let's just enjoy its beauty. Away, away in the Northland, where the hours of the day are few and the nights are so long in winter that they cannot sleep them through. Where they harness the swift reindeer to the sledges when it snows. And the children look like bears' cubs in their funny, furry clothes. They tell them a curious story. I don't believe this true. And yet you may learn a lesson if I tell the tale to you. Once, when the good Saint Peter lived in the world below and walked about it preaching, just as he did, you know, he came to the door of a cottage in traveling round the earth, where a little woman was making cakes and baking them on the earth. And being faint with fasting, for the day was almost done, he asked her from her store of cakes to give him a single one. So she made a very little cake. But as it baking lay, she looked at it and thought it seemed too large to give away. Therefore, she needed another and still a smaller one. But it looked, when she turned it over, as large as the first had done. Then she took a tiny scrap of dough and rolled it flat and baked it thin as a wafer, but she couldn't part with that. Part means to get separated. But she said, my cakes that seem too small when I eat of them myself are yet too large to give away. So she put them on the shelf. Then good Saint Peter grew angry, for he was hungry and faint, and surely such a woman was enough to provoke a saint. What is provoked to make him angry? And he said, you are far too selfish. You are far too selfish to dwell in a human form, to have both food and shelter and fire to keep you warm. Now you shall build as the birds too, and shall get your scanty food by boring and boring and boring all day in the hard dry wood. Then up she went through the chimney, never speaking a word, and out of the top flew a woodpecker, for she was changed to a bird. She had a scarlet means red colored. She had a scarlet cap on her head, and that was left the same. But all the rest of her clothes were burned black as a coal in the flame. And every country schoolboy has seen her in the wood, where she lives in the trees till this very day, boring and boring for food. So, done. So have you got some idea of the poem? First of all, in simple words, you might have noticed that this poem has a story within. Legend of Northland. This poem, A Legend of Northland, has a story in the poem, right? And when there is a story, it means there is a plot. So this poem has a good plot and a story. What kind of story is it? What kind of story is it? It's a story of the ancient times. The story doesn't seem to be of the contemporary or of the modern times, isn't it? The story seems to be of old times, that is ancient times. The setup is old. the story has a plot. What's the plot? Like the outline of the story is that once there was a woman, she was very greedy and selfish. Once a Saint Peter comes to comes by the cottage where she lives, and he, being a preacher, being a saint, you know, he always would keep on moving about thereby preaching people and all. So he was very tired and hungry. So when he was passing by that side where she lived, she stopped at her cottage and asked her to give something to him so that he could satisfy his hunger. So that woman, you know, she because it's a custom all over the world that we don't say no to, especially to the saints. Okay, the saints are respected all around. So that woman agreed that she would give him cake, and she started baking the cake. So when she had made the, when she had baked the cake for the first time, she felt that it was a very big cake, and she didn't want to give that big cake to the saint. So then she started kneading another part of dough and made another cake. And this time again the same thing happened. She felt that the cake was too big to be given to the saint. She started again baking the cake, and this time she made again a very small cake, but she felt that the cake was too large to be given. But she realized that if the cake, if she had to eat the cake, then the cake seemed so small. But if she had to give the cake, then it seems to be too big to be given. That is what human mind is. That is what, you know, mean people think like that. Okay, what mean people, you know, what the selfish people feel when they want something for themselves, they feel it's too less. But when they have to give the same thing to somebody, they find it too big that they cannot give it to the others. So that woman, you know, tried to bake smaller and smaller and smaller cake for Saint Peter, but each time she found it too big to be given. Finally, by this time, Saint Peter, who was already very hungry and tired, he grew very annoyed. He grew angry. He was provoked. So then he got so angry that he cursed the woman that she had no right to live like a human being. She had no right to have all comforts of a human life. What comforts a human life is born with? A human being is born with the comforts to have food, shelter, and clothing. And he said, like, you don't have the right to have these virtues of human life. So you don't deserve to have food, you don't deserve to have shelter, and you don't deserve to have food, shelter, or even clothing. So she was cursed by Saint Peter that she would be living a life without food, without shelter, and without clothing. So she was cursed to become a woodpecker. What does a woodpecker do? Number one, the woodpecker doesn't have any clothes on its skin. Okay, it has only one red cap on its head. And secondly, the woodpecker, what it does, it keeps on pecking at the wood. Okay, that pecking word which has been used in the poem is boring, b-o-r-i-n-g. Here boring is not that she was getting bored the way you people are getting bored right now, right? b-o-r-i-n-g, boring over here is pecking or piercing at something with sharp claws or with sharp edges. So the woodpecker is born with sharp edges. With sharp, you can say claw. So it keeps on pecking, it keeps on piercing at the wood for long time, for hours, right? To get food. So the curse of the, as a result of the curse of this Saint Peter, that woman turned into a woodpecker and started living a miserable life without food, without clothes, and without shelter. And always kept on piercing or pecking at the wood. right? So this is the structure of the poem. This is, you can say, the plot or the story of the plot of the story. So the story is within a poem. Okay, so there is a story within a poem. So the poem with a story, number one, I'm giving you some now facts. So the poem with a story, then structured stanzas. Each stanza has got four lines and we call it quatrain. Okay, so each stanza which has been divided into four lines, each stanza consisting of four lines, which we call as quatrains. So each quatrain has a rhyme, right? So structured stanzas, rhymed. So what kind of rhyming scheme is there? You can see at the text, Northland, that is A few, B, winter, C, and through, few, through. So A, B, C, B. What's the poetic rhyme scheme of the first stanza? A, B, C, B. So the same rhyming scheme is throughout in the poem. So in each stanza, the rhyming scheme would be A, B, C, B. You can check in the second stanza also. Reindeer, snows, cubs, clothes. So snows and clothes are same. The other things are all different. So A, B, C, B. So each stanza, so quatrains, four line stanzas are well structured. Okay, they all, every time the stanzas, their structures are same. Then they are all rhymed in a similar manner. Right? Then there is poem with a story, with well structured stanzas, rhymes, with all poetic devices. Story with a dramatic narrative. I've already written this. What is a dramatic narrative? Narrative is narration. Okay, the story has been narrated. Okay, when you start this poem, like away, away in the Northland, where the hours of the day are few and the nights are so long in winter that they cannot sleep them through. Okay, so they tell them, I'm talking about third stanza, they tell them a curious story. I don't believe this true. So somebody is a speaker. There is a explicitly speaker has been, you know, mentioned. This narrator seems to be the one who is telling us the story. Okay. And then he says, I don't believe this true. And yet you may learn a lesson. You. So the dramatic narrative is, I am the speaker. I means the narrator. There is a clear speaker and there is a clear, listener, you. So the readers are supposed to be the listeners and the speaker is also explicitly clear. So this is dramatic narrative, means the story has been narrated by an explicit narrator and the explicit listener. And the story has a normal beginning, like once upon a time in Northland. So the Northland where the days are shorter than the nights in winter, so that they cannot sleep them through. And the nights are so long in winter that they cannot sleep them through, means the nights are longer than the days, that you cannot sleep throughout the night. So where they harness the swift reindeer to the sledges when it snows. So it's about the snowing atmosphere. It's about the lifestyle of that place. So the point is, like the poet is, you know, the narrator is, he started telling us a story in a very simple tone. In the beginning, there doesn't happen to be any climax. In the beginning, there doesn't happen to be any adventure or any sort of provocation that we feel like, oh my God, it happened. We simply, you know, set to listen to the story. It's a simple narrative in the beginning. But I've told you, like, how does the poem end? The poem ends, the story ends where the woman was cursed and she turned into a... Come on, tell me, what did she turn herself into? She turned into a... Yes, Yes, Arshdeep.
The lady turned into a woodpecker.
Yes, correct. Well done, children. You all know the answer. Well done. So that, woman turned into a woodpecker. So that was something very strange. That is not something very easy to digest, isn't it? We were shocked. Oh my God, this is what happened. So story started with a simple storyline, with a simple situation, but ended up with a great, climax. The climax was there when she kept on baking the cake again and again, again and again. Then we as, audience, we as, the listeners kept on feeling like, what will happen now? Okay, and the result came to us that she was turned into a woodpecker. So this is called dramatic. What is dramatic? Many a times you people might have heard from your elders saying like, drama mat karo. Don't be a drama queen. And many a times parents say this. Who are the people? Which people are called as a dramebaz people? Drama. What is drama or drama? Being dramebaz or being dramatic? The people, those who create a lot of fuss. The people, those who create a lot of those who create the scene, those who make simple thing turn into something extraordinary. Okay. So here the dramatic narrative, the story has been told in a dramatic manner. Dramatic manner means the story starts from the simple level and goes up as far as the plot of the story is concerned. And with that, climax, the story comes to the conclusion where the wrongdoer is punished. Right? Right? The story started on a simple tone, reached the climax where the protagonist or antagonist, whatever you can say, did something which was very, very which was not at all expected. And we as listeners or readers were very apprehensive as to what would happen next. And as per our expectations, the wrongdoer, the protagonist, was punished in the end. And we got satisfied by the ending because we got to know that if you do wrong, then you will be punished. You will get the fruit of your result. Right? So the story, it is a story with dramatic narrative, right? And then there are well-structured stanzas. Well-structured stanzas, I'm saying, because there are four lines. And in each line, there is either a rhyme or unrhymed, but the whole stanza is rhymed, you can say. Then in between these stanzas, the poetic devices, for example, enjambment has been used or somewhere or the other, alliteration or simile or so one or the other kind of poetic device you will find in between. So the very beginning of the line, away, away in the Northland, away, away, it's you can call it a repetition also. And secondly, this is a assonance also. So away, away. So this is not, it's number one, it's the repetition of the same words. And secondly, it's the repetition of the vowel sound also. So assonance as well as repetition has been used, right? So well-structured stanzas in keeping in mind the poetic devices, rhyme scheme and all. So, right, all these things. And then there is a story within a story with dramatic narrative. So this is a ballad. So this poem becomes a ballad because ballad is a poem. This whole poem is a ballad. A Legend of the Northland is a ballad. Earlier, I just justified like what kind of poem is it? This poem has these qualities that it has a story within it. Secondly, what kind of a story? It's a story of a woman who experienced, who was greedy and was cursed. So it's a ballad, is a long story. It's a long narrative with well-structured stanzas with all poetic devices, right? And above all, the ballad is one which has a long narrative. Okay, long narrative, it is there. It's a story of somebody, yes, the narrator, the speaker, as well as the listeners are explicitly mentioned, that is there, right? So this is a ballad. Now let's come to the point, like, what's a legend? Legend is a, you can note down whatever I'm saying, or you can listen to me, listen to the video afterwards also. What is a legend then? So far we have discussed ballad. We have discussed dramatic narrative also. We have discussed, like, how this poem is a ballad. Then what is a legend? Have you heard this word legend earlier? Have you heard this word legend earlier? If yes, raise hand. What do you think is the meaning of legend? You are not to give me very 100% correct answer, but you might have heard of, you use this word many a times in your vocabulary. Children, legend, you might have heard somebody saying, yes, Anshaya, raise hand.
Hmm. Kind of a historical story that's not always true.
Anshaya, can you repeat, please?
Ma'am, legend is kind of a historical story that's not always true.
Okay, so according to you, legend is a kind of story. It's an old story which may not be true, right? Which is not usually true. Okay, but apart from the story, is there something else you use this word as? Do you use this word somewhere else, Arshdeep?
Ma'am, we had heard this word in context to Albert Einstein. He was referred as a legend by a mathematics historian.
Okay, so you say, like, you say that even Albert Einstein was a legend. Yes, so somebody who had been able to live an exemplary life. Unmute yourself, Arshdeep. So we, number one, legend is a story which may not be true, but has a moral. You can note down, children. Legend, number one, is a story, is an ancient story with a message or with a moral, right? And secondly, just a minute. Yes. So what I was talking about, number one, legend is a story with a moral. Secondly, legend can be a person who lived an exemplary life and who enriched the world with his contribution. Note down, legend is a person who lived an exemplary life and made the world a better world with his contributions. So there are so many legends. There were so many legends. You are talking about Albert Einstein, Abdul Kalam, Mahatma Gandhi. Okay, any person who contributed for the betterment of the world is a legend. The one who lived an exemplary life and later on, and when that person is no more, the world has been enriched with his ideas or contributions. All the scientists, okay, all the philosophers, all the literary people can be called as legends. You may talk about Shakespeare, okay? You may talk about anyone, whosoever wrote, and we are still reading that is a legend. That person was a legend. But one more thing, are legends the dead people only? Do we call only dead people as being legends? Yes or no? Even the, yes, Janvi, and Gia, anyone? Yes? Janvi, Gia, come on.
No, ma'am. We will refer to our teachers and mother as legends.
Repeat, please.
Ma'am, we also refer to our teachers and mothers as legends.
Okay, it's okay. You can call your teachers or your parents as legend, but let me rectify you. So the people, those who live an exemplary life, those who are live legends, okay, live, the people, those who are alive and are living exemplary lives in the present and are very famous for that, they are called as legends. Okay, anyone who has become famous because of something or the other, they are called as legends. Those who live life based on some ideology or principle, we call them legends. Okay, legend is a person who lives his life based upon some principle or on some ideology and has become famous. Okay, so rectify your definition a little bit. Legends are famous people because of their ideas, philosophies, or contribution. Right? Is that clear? So legend, even Mother Teresa was a legend. Why? What made her become a legend? Because she was an epitome of generosity, of nobility, of charity, of selflessness. Right? So in the modern times, if you talk about a person who is making the world a better world because of his contribution or because of his idea, you can call that person a legend. Right? So legend, we have discussed three meanings. One legend is a story. Story, it's an ancient story which is there in front of us. It's an ancient story with a moral. Right? Secondly, legends are the people, those who were there in the past and lived an exemplary life and enriched the world. And third, the even alive people can also be called as legends because they have become famous because of some great idea or something. Right? So tomorrow, children, we'll be, you know, going through the poem. It will take hardly 15 to 20 minutes to do the poem. These concepts were more important to understand, like what legend is, how this poem is a ballad, and what kind of dramatic narrative is there. There will be dramatic irony also we'll be discussing. We'll be discussing in detail what ballad is. There are so many other elements to be discussed that this poem is a ballad. Is that clear? Meanwhile, you people read the poem again very carefully and try to see like how far is this poem a legend. Whether it is a true story or not. If not, then why? If yes, why? Right? So there are some questions at the back of this poem. See these questions. So before we do these, though we have discussed this poem today, these questions you can go through today. Okay, just go through these questions and see whether you are able to find the answers to them. Right? These questions won't be discussed separately. These questions will be answered side by side in the poem. It's okay, children. Thank you. Tomorrow we'll be there.